Mr. Sheth here at Invest India. Let's get going with this, okay? So Invest India is a not-for-profit organization under the Ministry of Commerce, and Startup India is a branch of it, okay? So Startup India was launched in 2016 as a flagship event by Government of India, of course. And so basically what it does, it transforms all the ecosystem of startups. So everything and anything that is included in the ecosystem. So Startup India is your one point of contact for it. You don't know anything. Basically, its ideology is you don't need to do anything apart from your startup. You should focus on your startup. Rest of the stuff we should tell you, okay? So as I told you, it was launched in 2016. The main aim here is to bring all the stakeholders at one point, be it investors, mentors, corporates who conduct competition, startups, of course, or even startup enthusiasts. So if you have an idea, we have something there for you. If you don't have an idea, you want to do startups, we have an idea bank for you there as well. So there's anything you want to know, just Google and add Startup India word in the end, you'll surely get it on the website, right? So that's we are consolidating all the things at one point, so you don't have to do a lot of research and waste your time in other things. So what exactly is a startup? Now, based on innovation and all, startup can be anything, but for government definition, we do need certain parameters, right? So as an entity type, it should be incorporated only as a private limited company, LLP, or partnership firm. Its age shouldn't be more than 10 years from its date of incorporation. Now, incorporation and registration with Startup India are two different things. Incorporation is the company incorporation. So your company should not be more than 10 years old, okay? Your turnover should not exceed 100 crores in any fiscal years. And we are pretty loose on the last part because we think everything is innovative, okay? So if you're developing anything new, improving existing services, or basically if you are generating employment in any way, you are a startup. So how do you get that recognized? You simply apply to our portal and it gets, there are few fields you have to fill, like what's your CIN, what's the nature of your startup, service, industry, a brief about your startup. We examine that application and it's a pretty simple examination. If we understand it that, okay, you are doing this, well and good, you are a startup for us. Moving on, what's the startup revolution in India? Recently on 25th November, we crossed the 25,000 mark. So these are the numbers who are just recognized with the DIPP, that is Government of India. There are much more than that. But they of course have an edge over other startups. So it's spanning across 510 districts, 28 states, 8 union territories. So only Lakshadweep and Lakshadweep is missing out on it. We have 56% from tier 1 cities. There's been a rapid decrease from the tier 2 cities. It's 27%. But it has been almost doubled since one and a half year last. Yeah. So that's pretty much the data part. So once you're recognized with Startup India, what are the benefits that you are getting? So first of all, the million dollar question, the funds, right? So there's 10,000 crore funds allocated by SIDBI, that is Small Industries Development Bank of India. So it its nature is fund of fund. It directly doesn't invest in any startup. It invest in VCs. There are 46 or 47 VCs, right? 47 VCs that are registered with SEBI. It invests in that, and the VC has to, let's say the SIDBI invested X amount, so the VCs have to bring in 3X amount by themselves, okay? Now that seems a pretty much a big amount for them, but actually they have been able to bring in 8X amount so far. And then they invest in startups. So one way of getting funding is approach these VCs, okay? Of course, you have to do a lot of homework before that, but that is one way. Secondly is public procurement. The central government is the largest procurement entity in entire India. No one procures even near to that, okay? All Amazon, Flipkart and all combined. So once you're a DIPP recognized startup, what happens? You are open to government e-marketplace. So I will tell you a little bit about GeM. Other than that, there's CPPP and all. So you also get a lot of exemptions because you're a startup, wouldn't have prior experience or turnover, not enough funds to submit EMD. Well and good. The government has mandated that all central ministries, departments and PSUs have to give these relaxations. You don't need to have prior experience or turnover, or need to submit the EMD money. So that's a small amount of money, or even sometimes large enough for startups to submit before the tender is opened. Okay, so you don't have to do that. Patent and trademarks. So there's 80% rebate for patent. So once you file a patent, there's a fees that you have to submit. But there's 80% rebate on DIPP recognized startups, 50% for trademarks. Also, your application is expedited. So generally, before Startup India came, the average time it took was 5 years because there's less number of patent examiners in our country. But now the average has reduced to 3 years, and we also have startups who got their patent completed in like 81 days. Yeah, that's the smallest time they did in. Other than that, you have tax benefits, income tax. You don't have to, means you have to apply for the income tax exemption if you are approved by IMB, that's Interministerial Board. You get three years tax holiday. So you don't have to submit any tax on any of your profits for 3 years. Other than that, you have angel tax. There's a lot of facilitation that we get via mail, via calls for different from different startups related to different fields. So that is done for us. Just in case you don't make it, so we have an something for you as well. There's faster exit for you as well. Also, you have to comply with several laws. So self-certification is done. Means the onus is on you to take the responsibility this year. Now, there are 6 labor laws and 3 environmental laws, which you can say, yes, I'm following it. No one will come to check it. It will be done in 1 or 2 days. Okay, so that's there. So Kanika will take on from here and explain you the rest of the stuff. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kanika. In addition to what just Sagar said, I'll also take you through some other benefits we have apart from what has already been mentioned. So we also have a Startup India online hub, which connects the entire startup community, including 35,000 startups, 400 plus mentors, and 450 plus incubators. So we also have some portal benefits. The portal hosts a lot of templates for you to use. So we understand you may not be an expert on HR or legal or such other domains. You can focus only on innovation and your startup. So some very ready templates are already available on the website. We also host programs and challenges every now and then with various corporates, banks, or government entities, ministries. So as a part of these challenges, you get a grant. Whoever wins the challenge gets a grant amount of money, which is already pre-decided. So there are problem statements stated in those challenges, and the best innovation gets a grant as a result. So these challenges are hosted from time to time on our website. So you can just go to our website. It is an entire knowledge hub. You get everything related to Startup India on the website, and you can get information about those challenges also. So apart from that, to facilitate the entire thing, we also have a dedicated call center who you can call anytime for any of your queries. You can write to us on email. The queries that you write to us are not addressed by your call center, but our own team addresses each and every query that you write and tries to facilitate on a one-to-one basis. And also we have some corporate partnerships that you could that could really benefit you. So we've recently launched a challenge with WhatsApp, Facebook, wherein the first 500 startups on a first come basis can get $500 worth of credits to host their ads on Facebook. Apart from that, we do a lot of collaborations with various corporates time to time, so you'll have to visit the website to keep yourself updated. In addition to that, I would also like to tell you that we have partnerships with Zoho or Amazon, which render free services to startups for first 1 year of their starting up. So you can use Zoho ERP services or Amazon AWS cloud services also. Adding on to the procurement part, so GEM has recently launched in 2019 itself, GEM Startup Runway, which is a dedicated platform for startups to come and sell to the government. So exemptions on prior experience, turnover, and EMD are automatically available to startups on GEM. You can just, it's a very easy platform to register on. You can just go and register, sir. One of the members from GEM is also here to help you register today. These are some success stories from startups who have been able to sell their products through GEM. So CPP is Central Public Procurement Portal. It is another portal apart from GEM which facilitates public procurement. So all government departments are mandated to host their tenders above the value of 2 lakh on CPP. So this is one host of tenders across government departments. You can also register yourself on this portal. This also provides automatic exemption on the three things just mentioned and apply for tenders online. So these are just numbers you can look at of what we've achieved so far. And yes, that's it. You can write to us anytime, call on our call center, and we're available for questions after the session. I'll let the GEM session to move on now.
Can we start?
So, good afternoon to all of you.
Good afternoon.
So is it okay to go in English or Tamil? Which one do you prefer?
English.
Okay, good. So my name is Ramesh Magadevan. I am the business facilitator for GEM, Government E-Marketplace, for Tamil Nadu and Pondicherry. Right. So with respect to GEM, well, I am 2 years old in GEM. I've been working with GEM for 2 years, and GEM started 3 years back. 9th August 2016 was the day on which GEM was initiated, and I am associated with GEM for the past 2 years. And well, that is about me. You audible?
Yes.
Okay, so how many of you know about GEM? Let's first take a stock. I think I see some GEM notebooks out here in this room. So some of you would have already attended my program, or somewhere you would have attended this GEM session. How many of you know about GEM? Can the hands go up, please? Okay, so is it an humble answer? Fine, anyway. So anyway, I'm going to go from the fundamentals. So I'll take you through the fundamentals of GEM, what it is and all about. Okay, so okay, GEM stands for Government E-Marketplace. It's an acronym for Government E-Marketplace. And it is like Amazon or Flipkart. All of you would have transacted on Amazon or Flipkart, right? So it is something similar to that, but it is a portal for government buyers. When I say government buyers, it can be central government, it can be state government, it can be PSUs or local bodies or constitutional bodies, any of this actually. So basically, it is a platform, which will facilitate the buyer on one side and the sellers like you on the other side, okay, to bring on a singular platform with certain processes in place. So that is GEM all about for you, actually. But at the moment, only the government buyers can go and procure from GEM, okay? Shortly, you may find even the bulk purchases that can be done by you as a seller, as a buyer into this portal also. That is also possible. But at the moment, it is only the government buyers who can go and procure from it. So who can be sellers? Sellers can be anybody, anyone, okay? You basically belong to any one of these types. You can be a OEM, original equipment manufacturer, or you can be a reseller. You can buy the goods and sell it, or you can also be a service providers, actually. So these are the three classifications we have as a part of GEM, right? So the whole initiative started off on 9th August 2016, okay? That is when the, two groups of secretaries from Government of India, they brainstormed, okay, on, after their brainstorming, they found that the entire procurement, they wanted to be on a singular platform, right from the time they go and procure the products from the market to the time they make the payments to the supplier, entire process they wanted to be on a singular platform, and that was ably represented to our honorable Prime Minister, and from there came this portal. This was initially held by METI and the department, Department of Commerce and Industry. These were the two departments which were pitched earlier, and they brought in the first version of GEM. The second version came in February 2017. That is when the second version came in. That is when the GFR was amended. Okay, the GFR is the General Financial Rules, which is the Bible for central government institutions and organizations. Okay, so that got amended in February 2017. That is when the second version came into existence. And currently, if you log into GEM, you will be on the third version of GEM actually. So beyond, third version was released on August 26th, 2018. Beyond that, there is no version releases that has happened. So currently, if you actually log into GEM, you will be logging into the third version of it actually. Right? Basically, the GFR which we were talking about, GFR has got two parts. I need to talk about that because GEM is built around GFR. So we need to talk a little bit about around GFR. And not about all the rules in GFR, because you have lot of rules in GFR, but we'll be talking about only this rule 149. The rule 149 in GFR has got two parts. The first part mandating the central government institutions and organizations to only procure through GEM if the products and services are available on GEM, right? The second part talks about this bifurcation. It talks about the various modes of purchases. Okay, the thresholds ranges for the purchases actually. If the purchase is going to be less than 25,000 rupees, the buyer can do a direct purchase. It's called as DP normally in procurement parlance. So the buyer can do a direct purchase if the procurement is going to be less than 25,000. He can also do bidding, he can also do reverse auction here. The second type of procurement is greater than 25,000 and less than 5 lakhs. Wherein we have a process called L1 purchase, where three OEMs are compared for a particular product, and GEM will actually give you an OEM out of these three, which is at the lowest price, and the buyer is open to go for the direct purchase up to 5 lakh rupees, if he is going to procure that same product actually. If he is going to procure a different product, well, he can do that, but he can do it only through bidding or reverse auction. You cannot do it through a direct purchase, right? And then the third category, greater than 5 lakhs, where you can do only bidding. The buyer can do only the bidding or reverse auction, right? So these are the four types of procurement methods that are existent in GEM: the direct purchase, the L1 purchase, the bidding, and the reverse auction. And there's one more facility available on GEM where the buyers can choose the brand, specific brand. They can go and bid on a specific brand. That is through a process called PAC buying. It's called as a proprietary article certificate buying, where the buyer can choose a specific brand, okay, and bid for that actually. Bidding is also possible. Direct purchase is also possible. Depends upon this, the thresholds basically. If it is less than 25,000, he can go for a direct purchase. If it is above that, he has to go for a bidding or reverse auction. So these are the various procurement types that are available there. Bidding, of course, all of you know, but to explain how bidding happens in GEM, quickly I'll go through that. The bidding period is normally 10 days to 21 days. The buyer comes in. See, the basic thumb rule in GEM is that if the buyer will have to place his requirement on GEM, then whatever features he requires, okay, whatever features he is looking at, has to be available as a product in GEM, otherwise he cannot bid. So that is a thumb rule. If the product is not available for the features he require, he will not be able to do the bidding at all actually. So this is a thumb rule which has to be followed from the buyer's perspective actually. So he makes the bid, and once the bid is made, it is there for 10 days to 21 days, whichever number of days he is going to select actually. Assume that he is making it for 10 days. After the 10 days, assume that 10 people are bidded for that particular bid. So there is a two-stage process where the technical evaluation is done first, wherein he has given certain specific features, and you have given certain features, and he will just check that or compare that, and he can accept it or reject it based on his need, basically. So at that point in time, the finance part of it doesn't come into matter at all. So he doesn't talk about the price at that point in time. So it's only the technical evaluation that is done. So assume that out of 10 people, you are selecting 8 people. The buyer has selected 8 people. So only these 8 guys go for the financial evaluation. But at the financial evaluation, the buyer doesn't have much work. Automatically, GEM throws the L1 for him actually. Out of these 8, who is the lowest? That will be thrown to the buyer. So the buyer has the option to place the order only with that particular L1 actually. But supposing there are 2 L1s coming up, then there is a reverse auction that can come in, wherein the reverse bidding can happen. So the qualification for the reverse auction would be, let's say in our case where we took 8 people coming qualifying for the financial bid, out of that 8, the top 50% or the lower 50% will be qualifying for the financial bid, meaning L1, L2, L3 and L4 will be qualified for the reverse auction. So here what happens, the reverse bidding happens, okay, between the these 4 candidates. The remaining 4 is rejected, okay, the remaining 4 is rejected. Within this 4, the bidding happens, and finally an L1 arrives at the end of it, end of this number of days you have specified basically, okay. So in the reverse auction, the same bidder can participate multiple times, whereas the bidding, if one time the bid is made, that's the end of it actually. No, he cannot go and participate multiple times for that particular bid. He can go and participate for the other bid, but for that particular bid, he can participate only once. Is that clear? So that is about the reverse auction part. So direct purchase, L1 purchase, bidding, reverse auction, and of course the PAC, which I have already discussed about it actually. These are the various procurement methods that are available on GEM from the buyer's view, and I hope you also need to get to that, because depends upon what kind of purchases that have been made, you will have to make an appropriate delivery actually. Okay, now let me quickly touch upon the order process that happens in GEM actually. Through any of these methods, the buyer goes and places the order. Okay, once the order is placed, it goes into the seller's court. Seller agrees, he says yes or no, or maybe the seller will not respond at all, that's also possible. If the seller is not responding, GEM automatically cancels that order within 5 days duration. Within 5 days, the GEM cancels automatically. There's a scheduler that is running at the back end that goes and cancels the order at the end of the 5th day if the seller is not responding. Okay, the seller can say no to that order. If he says no, so be it, so the order closes. But if he says yes, the process continues, right? When he says yes, okay, he has to deliver it within the number of days. Yes, the buyer has asked, probably 15, 20, whatever may be the number of days the buyer has requested. So then the seller makes the delivery. When the seller makes the delivery, the seller creates the PRC. PRC is Provisional Receipt Certificate. Okay, what is that? He has to update the invoice date, the date on which the invoice is made into the system, and that's it. Just updating of the date means that he has created the PRC basically. So the PRC is created, then it goes to the consignee side, on the buyer side. The consignee will be there. The person, a buyer is somebody who places the order, consignee is somebody who receives the goods and services actually. So it goes into the consignee's court. Consignee accepts the product or rejects the product. Okay, he can fully accept the product, or he can partially accept the product, or fully reject the product. But when he is going to reject a product, he has to give appropriate reasons to that actually. And for the number of items that has been accepted, the payment will be made to the seller actually. So the next step is the payment. Once the payment is made, bill gets generated by the buyer, and the payment confirmation is made by the payment authority. That closes. By that time, you would have received the payment on your account actually, right? So this is the overall process. And in any of these processes, okay, if there is going to be a flaw, assume that the delivery date is skipped by you, what will happen? Who will complain about it? Who is going to complain about that? Buyer is going to complain. If If the payment is delayed, who is going to complain? Obviously the seller, right? So the complaints can be raised by both these parties. Both buyer as well as seller can raise complaints. Okay, that is getting tracked as an incident in GeM actually. It's called as an incident. Incident is nothing but any contractual violation that happens. It can be a pre-contractual violation or it can be a post-contractual violation. Post-contractual violation is this: delivery date getting skipped, payment not made, all these things are post-contractual violations. What could be a pre-contractual violation? Like, you know, you find a product of your competitor at some price which is unimaginable. Then you have a right to report that product, that facility is available in GeM. Suppose, let's say you find a laptop for 1000 rupees in GeM. Logically not possible, right? Logically not possible. So you can go, you have a right to go and report that product, that facility. That will create a incident in GeM automatically. So this is a pre-contractual process. Post-contractual is anything after the order is made. The connection between the buyer and seller is established. Is that okay? So this is the overall order process flow. So I have talked about what is GFR, what are the various procurement, GFR may you had two stages. Stage one talking about the mandatory nature, stage two talking about the various procurement thresholds, and based on that I had also explained to you the various procurement methods that are available on GeM, right? And also the order process, how the order gets traversed in GeM. Is that okay? Yeah. Okay, now coming to your side. So now I've given you the overall idea about what GeM is and how the whole process is happening there actually. Now what is that in for me, right? So that end of the day, that is the point, right? So you have got certain steps to go through to register on GeM actually. So the first step is to log into GeM and you click upon these sellers. You have a sign up link on your right hand top corner. Click on sign up sellers. Okay, then you will have to enter your constitution type. Your constitution type can be right from the proprietorship organization to the firm which is a partnership organization, or it could be a company, or it could be a government organization also. See, government organizations can also go and sell on GeM. That's also possible, right? Organizations like Elcot in Tamil Nadu, all of you would have known about Elcot, right? Elcot is a state government organization which can go and buy from GeM and also sell from GeM, right? So you have a facility for government bodies also to come and sell on this particular portal. And in some cases, the trust and societies can also participate on that. So these are the various entities, right? Proprietorship, firm, company, government bodies, central government, state government, then trust or society. So these are the entities who can register themselves on GeM. Is that okay? Then once you give your constitution type, then you have to enter your mail ID. You have to give Gmail ID is fine, Gmail or Yahoo is fine. But for the buyers, you know, they have to have a government email ID. So that is how we check that particular person who is logging in is a government entity or a private one actually. So you need to have the email ID. Any email ID you have to enter, that will be OTP will be sent to that email ID. Then that will be validated. Then you enter your user ID and password, whichever you want to do it, you put it. And once you click on my account, your account gets created actually. So just quickly, I'll run through the screenshots of these steps, whatever I have explained. So you go here, you select the type of organization, you select it as proprietorship, you enter the constitution name. Then you can either register yourself through either Aadhaar or through PAN. Now if you ask me, can a foreign company register on GeM? That could be another question that comes in your mind, right? Foreign company at the moment cannot register, but that company need to have a base in India or through some other reseller only, or a deemed OEM. Somebody can be a deemed OEM in India who can go and register into GeM. So for you to register into GeM, you need to have an Aadhaar number or PAN number. Definitely that is mandatory, right? So you enter your Aadhaar number and mobile number, do a verify Aadhaar. Immediately your Aadhaar is verified, it checks with the Aadhaar database, okay, and Aadhaar gets verified. user ID, password you enter, and you come here. So when you come here, it means that you have completed your, or you have created your user account actually. There is a separate PPT I have for doing the profiling part, doing all this. You can do, you are, then once you do that, all these things one by one you have to complete it actually, right? Matlab, you have to, what do you want to get yourself registered as? You want to get yourself as OEM, you want to get in as a reseller, or you want to get in as a service provider, or what is that you want to? So that part has to be given here. One important point I would like to bring in here is, if you are going to be an OEM, most of you will be, because if you are going to be a startup, startup will obviously be a OEM. So 99% I should say, for OEMs, you need to do a vendor assessment. Vendor assessment has to be done, which is mandatory for OEMs. Unless you have certain, exemptions, like, you know, your annual turnover is more than 500 crores or something like that. So only for those cases, some cases, which is already mentioned in the website. So for those cases, the exemptions can be there for the vendor assessment. Otherwise, by default, OEM, if you're going to be registered yourself as a OEM in GeM, then you have to go through the vendor assessment. Okay. So then you have to do the PAN validation, key person validation. Tax assessment may not be required if you are a startup, because you are anyway going to be registered. You can either register yourself with DIPP or not. Both ways you can get yourself into GeM. That's possible now. Okay. So you need to go through each and everyone so that you get all the things clicked on green actually. Right. So once you're done with this is the second stage. First stage I was talking about the user account creation. Second stage is this. Third stage is your product or services getting added. We will talk about that. So we'll stop here with the second stage and we'll go further in the startups part. So let me give you some inputs on the new features in GeM for the startups actually. So all the startups can now get registered on GeM. Okay, the part which we are discussing, carting, bunching, bundling, payment facilities, whichever process we discussed, everything is applicable for the startups also. Startups can now directly upload their products and services without any ratings. See, what has happened is 2.0 has been released. Startup 2.0 has been recently released, just last week, right? So it means that earlier what happened was you need to upload your product on the startup runway. Okay, and your two or three buyers will have to rate you basically. If they are going to give you a rating more than three, then only your product has a scope for moving into the mainstream of the GeM actually. But now that has been taken off. Now the common method you can follow, just as you add any category, the method which I have been discussing can be followed for startups also. It is just that if you are going to be an innovative startup, then there are some 12 classifications that have been given. Those categories are given. You just have to select those categories and try to upload it, right? Okay, I'll talk about it. But if the categories are not existing, what has to be done? That is the problem which most of you will be facing in GeM actually. For most of the generally used products and services, categories are available in GeM. Okay. If you are not finding the category for any reasons on GeM, okay, then you may have to request your buyer. The buyer has a facility to request for the category actually. So that will be, the category request will be raised by the buyer and it will be approved by the GeM, and once GeM approves it, that category comes on boarded actually. So this is the way, if for any reason the category is missing from your in the portal, you can go through this approach actually. Okay, then of course the you can add more than one product. It is not that just only one product or one service you can onboard on GeM. You can add any number of products, but an approval has to go through. I'll explain that part a little bit later. Startups can now participate. You can participate on a direct purchase or a PSE. PSE is proprietary articleship certificate. I explained that earlier. It is based on the brand. So suppose I as a buyer wants to go for a specific brand, okay, I can do a direct purchase on that if it is less than 25,000 rupees. If it is more than 25,000, I can go and bid for that particular product. If I'm going to bid for that product, only that OEM or the resellers of that particular product can participate in that particular bid which I am talking about actually, right? So that is about the PSE bid set. Simplified category creation for innovative products. That's what I told you, the runway part, it has been simplified now for you. You need not wait for the the approvals from or the feedback from the various buyers. That is not required now. So you can directly go and add the categories just as any other product actually. This is the overall process flow for startups. You have DPIIT registered startups can also come in. Startups who are not registered on this can also come in. So you have two routes here. Okay, so if you are DPIIT, I think Sagar has explained, Sagar and she has explained all about this exemptions. No prior turnover is required, no prior experience is required, no earnest money deposit is required if you have registered on this particular portal actually. So both joins here, you register on GEM. This registration is your user account creation, which I think I've already explained to you, right? And then comes the vendor assessment. I told you vendor assessment becomes mandatory since OEM is there. So if you're OEM, definitely vendor assessment is mandatory unless you fall under any of those exemptions, right? So vendor assessment is done by Quality Council of India. QCA does the vendor assessment. It is a two-stage process. GEM doesn't do it actually. What happens is you can initiate the vendor assessment from the GEM website itself, but GEM is not doing the vendor assessment. QCA does the vendor assessment, and that vendor assessment is chargeable, right? You do not have to pay any money for the registration process on GEM, but only for the vendor assessment the charges are will be there depending upon the turnover of your organization. There are a lot of other parameters that are there on which the cost is calculated actually, but it is chargeable. The vendor assessment is one time chargeable, definitely. That is done by the QCA. It's a two-step process, as I told you. First is the desktop assessment where you have to submit the documents, and the second level you will have a video assessment. There will be a video call based on your availability. There will be a video call that will be conducted by QCI, and finally they approve that actually, right? So in GEM you have only two main things. One is a category approval, then comes brand. Once the category is available, next is brand. Okay, if the brand is not available, you can initiate, you as a seller can initiate the request, and the brand gets approved within 2-3 days. Once the brand gets approved, you have to add your product and submit it for approval again. Okay, GEM authorities will have to approve that again. Once GEM authorities approve that, your product will be onboarded onto GEM. So basically, if you look at it, it is a four-step process. User creation, user account creation, that is the number one, step number one. Step number two, you will have to enter all your profile details. That will be the step number two. Third one, category is existing, no problem. Category is not there, go to the buyer, ask the buyer to create the category. Once the category is in, you have to see whether the brand is available. If the brand is available, add that brand. If it is not available, you can still go and request the brand. And once that is done, you add your product. Once the product is added, it goes for approval with GEM, and GEM approves it, your product is onboarded. Then the buyers across India can see your product. That is the beauty. Buyers across India can see your product. There are around 40,000 buyer organizations which are already registered on GEM. 40,000. As of today, as we speak, 40,000 buyer organizations are already registered on GEM. Okay, close to around 3 lakh. Suppliers are already onboarded, like you, already there on the portal. Transactions worth of 39,000 crores are already in on GEM, right? So it's a huge amount, and GEM is closely targeting around 1 lakh crore approaching this financial year till March to 2020. GEM is targeting close to around 1 lakh crore. That is the kind of target GEM is looking at. And it is a huge opportunity, I tell you, for you guys actually. You know why? Because you will have access to the entire India, the government buyers across India. Who will know? Somebody from Kashmir will place an order for you. You may not know. See, I would like to give an example of one lady from Tamil Nadu, right? So I always tell this in all my discussions. Mrs. Arulmozhi Saravanan, she is from Madurai, small village in Madurai. So she has somehow, you know, got in touch with GEM, and you know, she has made a small transaction, or she has enrolled herself on GEM, and you know, a small transaction was made. You know, who made the transaction? It was the PMO's office. She got an order from PMO's office, and she, you know, delivered that on time, and the payment was also, you know, it also came on time. Both sides happy, and you know, she is now you know, doing a big business of, I mean, 1 crore rupees. Recently, you know, Prime Minister also has talked about her in many of the Man Ki Baat sessions, and I think when Prime Minister visited Madurai also, she had an opportunity to meet her also. She met him actually. See, when that person can do, why not we, right? She is also a very small scale seller, very, very small scale seller. She was able to do that, right? And of course, I had an opportunity to interview her in Madurai. You know, very, very simple person, you know. So that is the kind of empowerment this portal is giving you. So which we need to take it up, and that's a beautiful opportunity that is coming to us. Why not we take it actually, right? So we'll move forward. So if you are a startup, you will get this number. Okay, so you can put that there. Okay, if you're not a startup also, you have an opportunity to register yourself as a this one. Yeah, there's a link that is provided to you there also, right? So of course, this vendor assessment, which is what we discussed. So you need to go through these forms, okay? And if you are falling in any of these innovative categories, earlier you have to put it on the startup runway and get the feedback from 3 different buyers. But now that is not required. These categories are available just as any other category. You just have to select that category and go. The procedure is same. You have to add the category, brand approval, product upload, product getting approved, khatam. Then you are into the system actually. Then the process will happen. The procurement process will happen. Okay. So if you want to add the new brand, this is the place. You know, this is the place you go and add the new brand. And this is a milestone I've been talking about to you. Close to around 40,000 buyers, and close to around 27 lakh orders that has been processed already. Around 3 lakh sellers and service providers onboarded. If you look at it, the beauty is 50% of. I'm sorry. Pressed wrong. Yeah, 50% of the orders, the 50% of the orders have come from MSMEs in GEM. I hope all of you are aware of this particular point, where the government organizations will have to, out of the budget that is allocated to them, 25% they have to buy only from MSMEs, and out of this 5% from the SCST MSMEs, out of this 25%, and 3 from women entrepreneurs. So such is the advantage you have on this portal, and that portal facilitates. You know, if you are an MSME, you can select the MSME. The buyers can select the MSME and find all the products that are there supplied by MSMEs. You can directly pick that up and proceed. Actually, that facility is also available. Okay, so the beauty here is, central government, it is mandatory. As per the GFR, they have to go through GEM. Biggies on the system, defense is procuring from GEM, railways is procuring from GEM. Okay, all these defense organizations, army, navy, air force, every one of them, they are procuring from GEM. Railway, you know, it's a bigger chunk. Railway and even ICF, and all the oil companies. You take, you talk about ONGC, you talk about IOCL, you talk about CPCL, all of these organizations are procuring only from GEM. You know, it has been mandated for them, which means they have to procure only from GEM. And if they are not finding the product on GEM, then they have to take exceptional approvals from competent authority, which normally the competent authorities won't give. They will question these people, right? So that is the kind of benefits you people have got here. Okay, and of course, Tamil Nadu government has also, you know, put that as optional. GEM is as optional, and Tamil Nadu has made a good progress now. As of now, I should say, close to around 350 crores worth of transactions have happened in Tamil Nadu at the moment. More so in the case of the PSUs and the central government entities, and certain states, especially you look at UP or other states, it has been made mandatory. In Tamil Nadu, it is not mandatory. In Tamil Nadu, it is optional, but in certain states, it is made mandatory. This is an open portal. It is all India for you. You are not going to transact only with Tamil Nadu or Puducherry. You are going to transact with this 40,000 buyer organizations across India. They are placed across India. Who knows? President's office may also place an order with you. Possible. This is only a marketing platform for you. You are saying, hey, I have this product. This is my product. I have it here. Okay. Any one of you want, you can come and take it. Right. So that is the kind of portal is this actually. Okay. It is purely a facilitation portal. You might have heard about DGS&D. People would have worked earlier with DGS&D, Director General for Supplies and Disposals. The DGS&D has been rechristened and it has been named as GEM now. GEM is a company. It's a company like any other company. Okay. It is a not-for-profit company, I should say. It's a not-for-profit company made under Section 8 law, actually, right? So, and this many number of orders, services we also have services on GEM. 62 services are available at the moment on GEM, actually, right? Okay, so I'll give you some more. I'll take you through the GEM portal. If we connect the internet, can we able to connect the internet here?